said that information is power. And if you are sharing information, if you are sharing knowledge, you are multiplying the power. So that is the spirit behind. So therefore we are sharing the information. So if you are sharing the information, then it has to be free. It has to be free. If somebody shares, that means it sharing the thing free of cost. So that is where the open access has come. And there is a story that the director of one of the very reputed funding agencies in the world called the Wellcome Trust, they had assigned, they have been funding for the research in the underdeveloped areas, underdeveloped countries. And there was one research why there are incidences of malaria in this some of the South African countries. And the research was done and the paper was published. And one fine morning when the director was checking for the research, it was not access to it. Because the message came that you are not authorized, you are not authorized to access. Because he has not paid for that. So the director got annoyed and said, if it is public money and we have paid for the research and it is not available to me. So thereafter, they came forward with the research journals which are freely accessible. This public library of science journals you might have heard, they are the outcome of that incident. Public libraries of science, POLS1, POLS biology, these are the recent additions to the international journals, which are very reputed journals. So likewise, there are a lot of stories. Think of it. You are a teacher, you are a researcher, you are doing your research, putting all your intellectual labor into, and you are sending your paper out for publication. Are you getting anything in return? No, absolutely not. And then the editor sends it to a referee for referee comments. He takes his own pain and does a lot of intellectual input into it. Does he pay? No, he's not paid. Then the paper is published. And the paper is highly priced. Where the money goes? The money goes to the publisher who has not contributed anything for the intellectual content of that paper. So therefore, many people in the world come forward and they said that nothing doing, we are now taking a vow that we will not be supporting for the commercialization of the knowledge content. So therefore, they actually started open access movement in the world. And we are living in that society today. And the institutional repositories are supporting this cause. And in India, we have seen a lot of repositories have been developed and institutions of national importance, including IITs and IIMs, NITs and all big institutions, you name it. Central universities, many of these central universities have their own institutional repositories. If you want to find out who and what research is going on in Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, you needn't have to go to the library or you needn't have to search publishers' content. You simply go to the Indian Institute of Science site and click on their repository and search what research been published there. So this is the usefulness of the institutional repositories, which for 2 days our resource persons are going to talk about. And for that you need a very systematic program for it, a software. And there are number of dozens of softwares are now available for this institutional repositories, knowledge repositories. And one of the best of those is a DSpace software. So in the world, if you take the users count, you will find next to US, it is India who are the maximum users of DSpace are available. So that software actually going to be detailed and through a hands-on experience to all of you by our resource persons. So this is the condition of the knowledge repository. And coming back to the plagiarism, as I said, both are integrated. The content that you make available should be free from plagiarized content. The plagiarism, simple thing is, plagiarism is if you are following if you are taking a part or whole of one's published content without giving a citation to, without acknowledging the source, then that is called plagiarism. And plagiarism has a broader meaning of kidnapping, stealing. As you steal somebody else's articles without asking them, similarly we are taking the content without their permission. And that is what, or acknowledgement. You need to acknowledge them. So that is what is known as plagiarism, and it is now very, very important, because today with some excitement or with a work pressure, with a challenge to meet the deadlines, because your assignment has to be submitted by 31st of March. So you follow that and you remain busy with work, and when 31st March comes, so you take the things and copy and paste and submit it. So there it comes, the case of a plagiarism. So we are vulnerable in academic institutions, and you might have seen that people at the topmost stature, being the members of parliament, the vice chancellors of the universities, big scientists of the world, have been put into task because of this plagiarism. So it is now the high time the UGC has realized, UGC has given the guideline that each of the institutions should have this software, plagiarism checker, before the submission of their academic assignments. So therefore they have come up with a course curriculum at the MPhil level, so that the MPhil students should know that what is plagiarism, how can plagiarism be avoided, what are the good practices, what are the research ethics and all that. So there will be a compulsory paper now in MPhil on research ethics and plagiarism. So that our students can really attend, so that they can in future, they will not be in trouble. So, and there are a lot of latest guidelines are now available to that, as Mr. Sir was referring to, and a special session is on that. Plagiarism is there, the resource person will talk about it. The UGC has come up with guidelines at four levels of plagiarism. Up to 10%, no plagiarism, you are a good person. And from 10 to 40, 40 to 60, and such 60 and above, for each level of plagiarism, there are different levels of punishment there. So we need to be actually aware of that. It will, this WhatsApp will actually solve that purpose of orienting and making you aware about the disasters of plagiarism, and how to avoid it, and how to prepare our students right from the beginning, so that they will not be into the problem and they will take up their higher studies. So, as I said, that prevention is better than cure. The same is true for coronavirus, and same is true for plagiarism as well. So, don't hide the content, don't take the contents, borrow the contents, and forget to acknowledge in a proper format. Acknowledging in a proper format according to the citation rules, the citation format, that is very, very important. Any content found on accredited, on attributed, on acknowledged will be considered as a case of plagiarism at any point of time. So, I think with this, I would like to conclude my talk here, and I wish all the best to all the participants here, and let the event very fruitful and very meaningful, and all of you would really go back with a lot of information and knowledge relating to the two important subjects. And once again, I would like to thank the organizers and for inviting me. Thank you so much.